Boy, you look great. Missed you so much. Carol and I got back a couple of days ago from Ohio. Had a joyous time with your brothers and sisters there and with Carol's parents. And God allowed us to come home. So we're back. Thank you for making it good and chilly. I like the 15 below over the last few days. You know, reminds us where we live. You wouldn't want it to be 40 degrees out there, would you? No. Okay. It's 40 degrees in Ohio. You could live in Ohio at 40 degrees, but here you gotta. So we praise God for that. We thank God for that. Do we have an awesome God? Do we have an awesome God? Amen. Amen. Yes, we do. Chuck, thank you for that, leading us in the Lord's Supper and reminding us how much God's plan is set and will happen. And amazingly, it's also true that we have free will. We are allowed to have our own choices. Now, if we could understand God, if you could understand and explain the Trinity of God, the three parts of God, if you could understand how he knows things, then he wouldn't be a God. I mean, he would be, we can't even explain ourselves, much less, you know. But God is beyond our understanding, and that's deliberate, and he presents himself that way. So when we look at his will be done, and yet he allows us to choose our own will within that envelope, and I don't know how he does that, but he does. We have been greatly blessed by you guys wherever we travel, everywhere we go. People talk to us about you and the effect you've had on their lives, or we see the effect of your workers who've gone out from here and are serving Christ in other places. Don't anyone ever let you understand or be convinced that you're not important, that you're not powerful, that you're not deeply loved, that you're not precious. All those things are true about you. You are powerful. You are deeply loved. You are precious. You are priceless. And even more so, not more priceless, but we're even more competent and powerful when we follow Christ. God put a great deal of himself. He made man in his image. We are made in his image. And our choices affect hundreds and thousands of people, for good or evil. He did that on purpose. You're precious and you're loved. Let's go to our Father in prayer as we start this lesson. Father, help us to grow in understanding your word. Help us to grow in knowing you. Help us to grow in following Christ. Help us to humble ourselves before you. Father, we don't want anything. We sometimes want things wrongly, but we really don't want anything to get in the way. If money gets in the way, make us poor. If our health gets in the way, make us sick. If our pride gets in the way, knock us down and take away all of our accomplishments. If our vanity gets in the way, tear us up so we have nothing to be vain about. Father, we don't want anything to get in the way of knowing you and being found in Christ. Please use us. Knock us down or stand us up, but we want to be yours always. In Jesus' name, amen. So I've been trying to have lessons throughout the years, last few years, on us growing in Christ and us being mature in Christ. I won't get into that part of the lesson. So this is a continuation of that, and this is looking at heart. We've been looking at mind, and I found so many lessons about loving God with all your mind that I never get to the other parts of Jesus' greatest commandment. So you just have to move on and go back and forth and back and forth because they all completely intermingle, and you'll see what I mean. Loving God with all our heart. We read this morning about, let's turn to Psalm 51, out of Psalm 51, about being broken. Being broken. The words, if you're looking at your Bible, Psalm 51, the words for the music director, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet came to him after he had gone into Bathsheba, are not some editorial addition. It is part of the psalm. That is included in Hebrew in the ancient scriptures. This psalm is given to us specifically in the context of David's awful mass of sins that he did, one sin after another, and tore up his own family, tore up his own nation, destroyed Uriah, tore up what Bathsheba had been hoping on. He tore up a lot of things. And this psalm is written by him in that context. So in verse 17, when he says, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, you will not despise." He's making a statement about his own brokenness, about his own awareness of what a catastrophe he has created and how destroyed he is from his own actions, how he has taken God's gifts, God's many, many, many blessings and gifts in his own life and made a mess. Broken and contrite. It is essential to our Christian walk. It is essential to our following God. It was essential in the Jewish context before the Messiah had come, and it's essential in Christ in following the Messiah of the Jews, in following the Christ. Brokenness and contriteness are essential to who we are. We can be like David. David was after God's heart. David was a king who put his faith first day after day after day, except he let his own will take over. So it can happen to us. When we are focused on serving God, when we are focused on being passionate for God, when we are focused on following his word, on loving with his kind of love, that we can let our will, that we talked about a minute ago, God's will always being accomplished, but our will being allowed, we can take our will and make great destruction in it. Brokenness is so powerful, and it is necessary. It is essential to being a Christian. Let's look at Psalm 51 with a little bit of specificity. Psalm 51 is David's cry for restoration. This isn't this lesson, but there's a real strong lesson. If you want to write a comparative Bible study, compare what the first king of Israel, Saul, did when his sin was put in front of him. Saul was shown his sin. Remember that he did not obey God in the battle and let spoils be taken, and wanted to conduct the conclusion of the battle in his way rather than in exactly the way God had said. And Saul spent the rest of his life. That's why he went to the witch. That's why he did all sorts of ridiculous things. He spent the rest of his life trying to find a way to recover. He went everywhere. You look through it. Read it. He went everywhere except to God. Saul went to his priests. Saul went to his advisors. Saul went in every direction, but not one time in the rest of Saul's life is he praying before God. If I've missed it, show it to me. David, after Nathan shows him, we'll see it in a second. After Nathan shows him, went immediately to God in prayer. And if you want to weigh sins before God are wrong. Saul didn't destroy a family over what he did. David had a heinous sin before God. But let's look at Psalm 51 and the sequence of it. First of all, David starts with his knowledge of God. We talked about just a minute ago, loving God with all your mind and how powerful our knowledge is before God and in our walk in Christ. We need to be people who know God, know who he is, know what he is, know how he thinks, know how he acts. I know he's beyond us, infinitely beyond us, but he gives us detail after detail after detail after detail after detail of the kind of God he is. And David uses those things here. It's when you get in trouble that you know you have a God of passion, that you have a God who says, I am rich in mercy, that you make a mess of something. Go to God. Praise God. And David spends his time here. He talks about in verse 1, God's faithfulness, the greatness of his compassion. Verse 2, he acknowledges that God is competent to wash him and cleanse him. He knows he has a God who can and will be willing to do those things. He knows that all sin, all your sin, you've lied to somebody, yeah, you've lied to somebody, but your sin is before God. It is God you have stepped on. It is God you have hurt. It is God you have ignored. And so he says famously in verse 4, against you, you only have I sinned. All other sins fall under the fact that we are violating God himself. So David understands God's greatness and his holiness there. You are justified when you speak. You are blameless when you judge, end of verse 4. You desire truth, verse 6. You will make wisdom known, verse 6. And on it goes. David starts this and paints this, his repentance before God with all of this praise and all of this knowledge of who God is. Praise for God needs to be on our lips and on our tongues and ready in our minds. It shouldn't be something we have to look for. Give thanks in all circumstances. Rejoice always. It shouldn't be things we have to look for. We are ready with thankfulness. We are ready with praise. We are ready with our compassion in following God. David's confession is complete. He lists out his sins. He starts with his wrongdoings. He calls it, verse 2, his guilt, his wrongdoings. My sin is constantly before you. I have done what is evil, verse 4. I was brought forth in guilt and in sin. He goes all the way back to his origins. In sin did my mother conceive me. And so just for a half second, that's either literal, that David was an illegitimate, was not the result of Jesse and his mother. Remember, David was left out of Jesse bringing his sons out, right? When they were looking for a replacement for Saul, they went to Jesse to find a replacement. Jesse brought out all of his sons. He said, wait, you got one more. Oh yeah, him. This is either literal, that it was a sinful relationship that caused his mother to be pregnant. Either, well, it could have been Jesse, maybe they weren't married. But it could be literal that in sin his mother conceived him. Or it could be a poetic perspective, just saying, my sin is throughout my life. It goes all the way back to my conception. I mean, it could be just that much passion and poetry that is being thrown out there. But whichever it is, I tend to think it's the first. He says, I'm sinful before you, Father. I'm sinful before you. He's complete in his guilt. His confession is open. He's not withholding anything. He's broken and contrite to the core. Verse 8, let the bones you have broken rejoice. I'm always touched by these phrases. It's written a few times in the Old Testament, where to keep a lamb, to keep a sheep from running away again, if you have an ornery sheep, anybody here ornery? Ornery sheep? Thank you, Jaina. Jaina and I are the two ornery ones here. If you have an ornery sheep that won't behave and won't stay, it sounds horrible. But to keep it from the wolves, you break its leg. And then guess what? It doesn't go anywhere at all. You have to carry that sheep. You carry that sheep. which is exactly what Christ does for us. He carries us. And we thank him that he has broken our leg, that the pain of this anguish in my life has brought me closer to you, Christ. Thank you that my bones thank you that you have broken. They rejoice. His brokenness, his contriteness is to the core. And he says, of course, which is the core of what we're trying to study here, the sacrifices of God. He says, you're not interested. This is done several places in the Old Testament. You're not interested in more sacrifices, more burnt offerings. I know if you were, Lord, I'd give that. Could you imagine how tired God would get of our empty prayers? I'm not accusing anybody in here of empty prayers, but I know I've had them. You ever read the Bible and not notice what you read? You ever come to church and just go through the motions and shuffle off home looking forward to lunch? We've all been there. Going through the motions, we know what we're supposed to look like, we know what we're supposed to act like. He says, I'm not interested in your sacrifice. And David said, I know that about you. You do not delight in sacrifice, otherwise I would give it, verse 16. You do not take pleasure in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. He goes to the core. He goes deep. Heart in Scripture is not emotions. Modern world describes heart generally as our emotions, what drives us and motivates us emotionally. Heart in Scripture is the core of your person. What are your convictions? Who are you really? How do you really think? What do you really want? And I know Satan has been able to get in some of our minds some really ugly images. And if you fight those and hate those, that is not who you are. That is just some lost battles against what Satan has done to us. He goes to the core. A broken and a contrite heart, you will not despise. And finally, look at the end of this. He goes to worship. I didn't misspell that one. That's fellowship. I even caught myself when I went back over my notes, went, oh, I misspelled fellowship. No, I didn't. I wrote fellowship. Our fellowship then comes when you've got an understanding of God, however, whatever level that is. An openness, a vulnerability, completeness of confession. You dig down to the core of how deep you've desired and hung on to this sin, and you're contrite to the core. Look what happens in verse 18. He just said you don't want that kind of physical worship, but in verse 18, by your favor do good to Zion, build the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in righteous sacrifices. David's not erasing the law or the sacrificial system by saying, you do not delight in sacrifice. He's saying, you want my heart. When God's got our heart, then our worship follows that. Then you will delight in my righteous sacrifices, in burnt offering and whole burnt offering. And then bulls will be offered on your altar. I'm responsible for getting my heart straight and connected to my Father and into my Lord. Then my worship comes clear and through. In fact, it's natural. Then worship becomes natural, not awkward. And by the way, there is no scripture, almost literally, there is no scripture and explanation of this gathering being called our time of worship, our worship service. This is our assembly. We are people who worship God 7 days a week throughout our lives. This is simply a time we come together to assemble together for all sorts of growth and edification and worship together. But we don't start worshiping when we get here, and we don't stop worshiping when we leave here. We are people who worship God. So this is a sequence I see out of David lays out for us in Psalms 51. But let's talk about brokenness and contriteness. What is it? What is it? It's eyes and heart open to the truth. Remember, we started with a knowledge and an understanding of who God is? When we understand God is holy, we understand that there is a violation of that holiness that the world lives at and lives in. The sin, the disobedience, that's true. Evil is evil. God is holy, all good, all glorious, all majestic. He defines love and gives it generously, rich in mercy and grace. On and on is the majesty of God. And this world has this horribly playful way of teasing us along a path toward evil. Oh, it's okay. Oh, it's okay. Look how funny that is. Isn't that hilarious? Come on, try it out. Or that feels so good. Or your troubles are heavy. Come join us in dealing with your troubles, and we'll help you forget them. We need eyes and heart that see what's really going on. How glorious God is, how awful evil is, and who we are. How precious we are. We are not worthless. We have maybe made a mess of things, but we are made in God's image, and He loves us, and He wants every one of us to be with Him for all eternity. Every one of everybody, not the us here in this room or in this state or in this country, but everybody everywhere over all times. He made every one of us. And in that, when we see who God is and we see who we are, if you're seeing with open eyes, you will be humble. Or you better be. Or you're not seeing correctly. Being humble before God is seeing God as He sees you, as you really are. That's a good definition of humility. It's not a worthlessness. It's not a pushing yourself down or off to the side. It's understanding how precious you are, but how incompetent you are. Do you mind that word? We are not competent to run our own lives. We cannot. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. Not nothing, but nothing that lasts. Nothing that's precious. Nothing that's valuable. Good only comes from God. Without Him, we can do nothing. And vulnerable, man, we could have 10 lessons on being vulnerable. Humility and vulnerability are right. They're neighbors. They're best friends. Being vulnerable. Okay, let me tell you about it. Yeah. Opening yourself up. Quit putting on the mask. Quit pretending to be something you're not. Quit pretending that everything's okay. Quit pretending you don't have sin in your life. Oh, I tell people, I got sin. No. Not that phrase. Open up. Talk to somebody about what really hurts, about your real anguish, about your real sin, about your real weaknesses. When you open up and you give Christ your weaknesses, you know what He does with them? When I am weak, then I am strong. But it takes vulnerability to get there. These are too much explanation in each one. Hate evil. Hate the evil that the world lays out before us. Because you know how awful it is? It's so awful that it required killing one animal after another, after another, after another, after another for thousands of years. The sacrificial system had to be put in place. Ugly parade of blood and offal. It's a reminder of how awful evil is. It destroys you. It destroys your eternity. It destroys your family. It destroys your relationships. It destroys your future. It's awful. Don't play with it. Don't cuddle up next to it. Hate it. It is worthy of your hate. And love God. He's more than worthy of our love. brokenness, contriteness have these elements at their base. Accept responsibility like David did. David said, the blood guiltness is on me in the middle of Psalm 51. I'm the one who got Uriah murdered. He didn't use those words, but he talked about how guilty he was of the blood. He caused the death of that man, and he caused the ruination of that family, and he caused the ruination of his own family, although he didn't see all that yet. Seek God's will. Seek God's will completely and only. I don't want to run my life. I cannot run my life. I am not competent to run my life. Brokenness and contriteness, and then change. Stop doing what you've been doing. You heard me say it before. Let's get back to normal with this pandemic. We don't want to go back to normal. Whatever my normal was before, I don't want it. I need to change in Christ. I need to be a different man. I need to be a different servant to you. I need to be a different elder. I need to be a different husband. I need to be a different father. All of those had clumsy, selfish, shallow parts in them. And I need to change. And so do you. Change. Do not stay where you are. That is kind of the opposite of brokenness and contriteness. David said, create in me a new heart. I need a clean heart. My heart is a mess. Change me, God. Please change me. In one phrase, yet not my will, but yours be done. Who said that? Who's that quote from? Jesus in the garden. Jesus had a human will in him that he had to rebuke and submit to his heavenly Father. Real quickly, you can just write down these verses. We'll do a little bit of a skim through. But here's some people in Scripture, starting with what we just read about David, a little bit of David's situation in 2 Samuel 12. We don't have time to read through it, but it's that powerful story that Nathan, right? Verse 1, Nathan comes to David and says, let me tell you a story about a rich man with a bunch of sheep and a poor man who only had a little lamb. You know the story. The rich man had some visitors coming in, and he didn't want to kill one of his many nice sheep, and so he takes the poor man's little lamb, and who loved his lamb, who loved his only sheep, and he kills that lamb to feed his guests. David gets angry. David gets righteously angry in his pride, I think, because David wasn't looking at his own life. But David gets angry about this. And then Nathan says in verse 7, the famous words, you are the man. You're the rich man who stole the poor man's only lamb, David. And then gives David the rebuke. You are the one you're condemning. Don't you see it? And amazingly, in the middle of it, he says, quoting God, Nathan says, if what I had given you had been too little, I would have added more to you. Many more things like these. You see, when you have any desire in your life, if it's a good desire or you think, oh, that's pretty, I shouldn't be desiring that, I shouldn't be, take it to God. You want more money? Because you're selfish and want a lot of money around you, go to God. Don't go anywhere else and talk about it. Take it to your heavenly Father. You're fighting with lust. You're lusting after people, either in porn or in walking down the street. Take it to God. That's exactly what David was suffering from. And rather than taking it to God, he settled it himself. First thing David says after Nathan's rebuke in verse 12, then David said to Nathan, I have sinned. No justification, no argument. He didn't stand up and walk out of the room angry that somebody would dare speak to the king this way. Oh no. Broken, and contrite. I have sinned against the Lord. And the first thing he did in verse 16, of course, the child that Bathsheba was pregnant with because of David was destined to die. That was part of Nathan's message. David pleaded before God for the child, and David fasted and went and lay all night on the ground. His first action was prayer. His first words were confession of his own sin. That's brokenness. Isaiah chapter 6. Very famous piece of scripture. In the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Seraphim were standing above him, each having six wings. Two covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called out to the other and said, Isaiah 6, now verse 3. One called out to the other and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of armies." Three times repeated in the tradition of Hebrew faith, of the faith of the Israelites, three times given to us from God is completeness, absoluteness. God is absolutely holy, absolutely holy, absolutely holy. The whole earth is full of his glory, and the foundation of the thresholds trembled at the voice of him who called out while the temple was filled with smoke. And then I said, so here's Isaiah facing this. Woe. Woe to me. I am ruined. What sin had Isaiah committed there? None. It's his vision. But in the vision, he sees the reality of who God is. Obviously, he did not see the fullness of God. He saw some aspect of who God was. It was a vision, not a piece of spiritual reality. So this wasn't going to kill him like Moses or like we're warned about in the New Testament. Woe to me, for I am ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of armies. Help! What's he immediately go to? I'm not worthy. I'm not clean enough to see this. I don't even speak righteously. My lips, my words are unclean. Famously, the seraphim flies over to Isaiah and touches his lips with a burning coal. And cleanses him from his unclean lips. Help! That's brokenness. He didn't sit back, wow, look at this, that's really interesting. No, he went immediately to the reality of who God is and the reality of who he is, and he says, I'm not worthy to even stand here. What, I'm going to die. What am I, he's broken before the Lord. Saul, chapter 9. Saul, this is the one who will become Paul. Saul, Acts 9, verse 1. Now Saul, still breathing threats and murders against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked for letters from him to the synagogue in Damascus. So Saul famously is going to persecute the church in Damascus, and on the road, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him, verse 3, and he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, Who are you, Lord? I am Jesus whom you're persecuting. Get up and enter the city. And for 3 days, verse 9, Saul was without sight and neither ate nor drank. God speaks to Ananias in verse 10. He tells Ananias in verse 11, Saul has been praying for 3 days. You're the messenger. Ananias doesn't like that idea, and God says, you go anyway. I'm not interested in how much you like this idea. That's my editorializing, excuse me. And he says to him in verse 17, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, whom appeared to you by the road on which you were coming, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like fish scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight, and he got up and was baptized. And he took food and was strengthened. Now, for several days, he was with the disciples who were in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." And all those hearing him continued to be amazed. That's brokenness. Plenty of sins going on in Saul's life there, but that's not the focus. It wasn't the personal sins. It was the violation of God's will. And when Saul ran into him violating the very Messiah who he had been waiting for, he changed. He became a different man. He was broken and contrite, was baptized into Christ, stood up, and told others in extreme danger to his own life and safety, because that's what he was already there for, to bring people into prison, and if they weren't cooperative, to have them executed. Acts 22:16 gives us a detail to this in which Ananias says, "Saul, what are you waiting for? Get up and be baptized and wash away your sins." His contriteness started immediately. It was like a little bit like Isaiah. He didn't have an option here. He was blind dead. Isaiah didn't have an option. The vision came to him, and he was overwhelmed. Not knowing what was going on, he didn't eat, he didn't drink, and he was praying for 3 days. "Well, God, your will. I don't understand this. I don't understand this. What am I doing wrong? What's going on? What's going on? God, help me. Please help me. Explain this to me. God's will, not my will." That's brokenness. And finally, Peter. We're going to start toward the middle of information we have about Peter. The end of how we know Peter is being taught by Lauren in his Sunday morning lessons out of 1 Peter and the letters of Peter. We're talking about Peter in the middle of his time as an apostle in Galatians chapter 2. When Cephas came to Antioch, verse 11, Paul opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. Can you imagine telling an apostle, "Hey, knock it off, you're wrong"? That's what Paul's good for. "Prior to coming, some men from James used to eat with the Gentiles, but when they," meaning Peter, "came, he began to withdraw and separate himself, fearing those from the circumcision. And the rest of the Jews joined him in hypocrisy. And the result was that even Barnabas was carried away from their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not straightforward in the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in the presence of all, 'If you, being a Jew, live like the Gentiles and not like Jews, how is it you compel the Gentiles to live like Jews?'" The separatism, the violation of unity was being led by the apostle Peter. And Paul wasn't going to stand for it. You know what? We're never given how that was resolved. Did Peter himself walk out of the room? How dare you talk to an apostle that way? We get a good hint by jumping back a few books. Look at Matthew chapter 26. "And later the bystanders came up and said to Peter, 'You really are one of them as well, since even the way you talk gives you away.'" You know where this is. Jesus has been arrested. He's being flogged. He's being interrogated. He's being beaten in all sorts of ways. Peter's not far from them, warming himself near a fire. And the crowd asks him, "You were one of his followers." And Peter says, "No, I wasn't." "Yeah, you were." "No, I wasn't." And this is the third time. In verse 74, "Then he began to curse and swear, 'I do not know the man.' And immediately a rooster crowed." And Peter remembered the statement that Jesus had made, "Before a rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and wept bitterly. That is his sin again. He cussed, he lied, he betrayed, he denied even himself because he promised he wouldn't do that. That's brokenness. He saw himself for who he was. He saw himself for what he had done. And he went out and wept. We know he didn't give up because Jesus pulled him close later on. But that's another sermon. But I do want to go back to Peter's earliest, kind of the best. Oh, all these are good aspects of brokenness. All these are good lessons on brokenness. All these stories, and many more in Scripture, by the way. But I just can't get away from how awesome Luke 5 is. This is Jesus at the Lake of Gennesaret. He's talking to the crowds. There's two boats there. The fishermen are drying their nets, cleaning their nets. Peter, of course, is one of them. Jesus gets in the boat, asks Simon to push it out into the water, and you could just see, I'm done. I've been fishing all night. These aren't his words. These are my editorializing. And you want me to put, and you can't, why don't you stand here? They can hear you. Okay. Peter was cussing after 3 years with Jesus. You think he's not a cussing fisherman now? This is not a warm and friendly good Jew. He's a rough man. Okay, I'll push out. He continued teaching the crowd, verse 3, and when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon responded and said, Master, we've worked hard. You know I love this. You know I've said this before. We've worked hard all night and caught nothing, but I'll do as you say and let down the nets. And when they had done this, they caught a great quantity of fish, and their nets began to tear, and they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they filled both boats to the point that they were sinking, two boats so full of fish, two boats of sinking after a night of catching no fish at all, zero fish. Does Peter think about the money he's going to make in the market? Does Peter think about what an awesome fisherman he is? Does Peter think about, wow, this is a great day. Look at this. Woohoo! None of that. Not even the miracle. Not even the miracle. Peter's natural brokenness goes immediately to who he is. Get away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man. That's brokenness. You see God, even if it's a sliver, even if it's just a sliver played out in fish, imagine that. See God for who he is, and whoever this teacher is, I can't tolerate this kind of righteousness. Get away from me. I'm a sinful man. Jesus says, I got more work for you to do than that. You're going to catch people. And immediately they left everything. Immediately, it says at the end of verse 11, they brought their boats to land and they left everything and followed him. That's brokenness. That's brokenness. Instantly. It's the quickest transition. It's immediate transition in Scripture. At least Paul had 3 days to figure out and to pray to God and listen. It's seeing clearly. And Peter was so natural at it. He was so natural at making a mess of things, but he was also really natural at coming back. So when you go back to how did Peter respond to Paul in Galatians? You fill in the rest of that story. Last week, we were watching a movie with Carol's parents, and this scene came up in the movie. And I'm doing this lesson on brokenness, and I went, that works. The movie is War room. I have it written right here, but I had to think of it. I'm not advocating. It's a wonderful movie. It teaches some wonderful lessons. And this is the dad in the movie who's been making a mess of things. And his wife is spending her time praying for him after she had to get some things figured out for herself. And he's looking at a note his daughter's written about her prayers for her daddy. This man has been going to church with his wife and child. He's been leading prayers at the dinner table, but he's making a mess of things. So, he's in his daughter's bedroom. He doesn't understand why they're praying for him.
Jesus, I'm not a good man. I'm selfish. I'm prideful. And I'm hurting this family. But this is not who I wanted to be. I don't like the man I've become. But I don't know how to fix it. I don't know what to do. Forgive me, please. Forgive me, Jesus.
It's a movie. The actor looked him up, very serious about his faith, has acted in several of these movies like this, faith-based movies. He's very serious about his own faith in Christ. But we've seen it. God has a way of bringing us to that. I just want us to have a handle on that in our own lives. We can know what brokenness means in a present knowledge before God. That we live as repentant people. We live as people who are aware of who God is and aware of who we are and hate sin and love Him. Yet not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, God, but yours be done. It is essential to our Christian walk. If any here this morning have prayer requests, if you're ready to be baptized into Christ, if you have any need at all, we desperately want to help you in your walk of faith. If you want to study afterwards or have needs, please open up to somebody. Don't walk alone. Walk arm in arm with a brother or sister. Thank you so much. Let's stand and